What's up? This is Arlington and I just landed right now. I'm about to make a big purchase today. Y'all stay tuned. Probably, I don't know what video I'll be discussing, what purchase I'm doing today. But today we're going to be interviewing a guy that has been in industry for probably over 30 years. He does all Fort Myers pest control car dealerships and I'm looking forward to that. So let's continue and learn more about his journey and how he got to where he is right now. Okay, awesome. Here we are with Stuart, the owner of Texas A1 Pest and Termite.
Hello.
Okay, nice to meet you. So the first question I had was, actually tell us about your story and what got you into pest control.
What got me into pest control over 30 years ago was my brother was in the pest control business and he recommended that I check it out. I'd always been in sales, mm-hmm. and I was in a lot of outside sales where people didn't want to see me. Mm-hmm. Things like I'm old enough to you don't even know what a dictaphone is, which was a which was a dictation device, mm-hmm. that doctors and lawyers use. But I sold stuff like that and life insurance and all, and nobody wanted to see me. Mm-hmm. And so that was a hard sell. But in pest control, I found out that people have an issue. We have an answer. And so once I found pest control, I stayed in it for the last 30 years. So that's how I got into it. The way I got the company that I have now is I partnered up with some people over 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. And joined with them, brought a big account in, and then eventually bought them out. So that's how I am where I am today.
Nice. And then how many trucks do you have out there working?
Right now we have three.
Three.
Looking to expand to four or five in the next year. But I want to be careful about that because of the way that I like to do business, which mm-hmm. is all through relationships. Mm-hmm. And so it's real important that anybody we bring in understands our culture, understands that it's always the customer first, mm-hmm. That the money will come. I never really worry about how much something costs. If it comes down to whether the customer is happy or not, mm-hmm. It costs you a lot more to make people mad.
No, yeah, that's true.
Than it does to make them happy. Mm-hmm. So I'd rather invest today and have them talking good about us as opposed to, you know, trying to save a nickel here, mm-hmm. or even a dollar. You know, I mean, it can get expensive taking care of people, but our philosophy is that people don't buy a service, they buy a solution. And if you sell them something and you don't solve the problem, then you haven't done what your job is. So that's kind of how we built our business and how we are, you know, how we got to where we are today.
I like that advice. Good, very, very good insight. Okay. So what do you use to do your transactions? Do you have Square or some sort of?
Yeah, we do. We have, it's called Clover. It's like Square, but you know, we can process it either here or we can process it in the field. So that's what we use now. You know, a lot of people ask about Zelle and mm-hmm. things like that, which I haven't looked into too much, but I understand Zelle between people is no fees, but
no
Zelle,
fees. I love it.
But Zelle commercially mm-hmm. is supposed to have fees, is my understanding. Mm-hmm. But I don't know that they do that yet.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I haven't looked into the commercial side, but I know the residential side is like no fees. It's easy, and I mm-hmm. have a lot of customers that they just sell me. Mm-hmm. You should try it. I mean, yeah.
Makes sense if they're not going to take a fee out of it.
Exactly. Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay.
So when they Zelle you, do they Zelle you personally or are they Zelling your company, your
my company
name?
Company's card. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Yeah. So yeah, three trucks. So how many customers do you recommend? Or is there certain customers or certain revenue that I need to achieve in order to have a second truck going?
Because I only have, you know me, I only have one truck.
And that's probably the most difficult thing to figure out in our business. But I think the most logical way to figure that out is, okay, a truck's going to cost me X amount per month. Mm-hmm. The rig in the back, even though it's all up front, you can still break it out into a monthly. Say the rig's $2,400. So now that's $200 a month that person's going to have to cover, at least for the first year, you know, while you're paying
Of course.
Gas, insurance, liability insurance, all of his equipment, his B&G, everything. Figure all of that in and say, okay, so this is what all this is going to cost for the first year. So he's got to do X amount of jobs, and it's got to be new customers. It can't be old customers, because you're bringing in this guy and you're bringing in new expenses, so you have to have new money to cover these new expenses. Otherwise, you're using old money to cover these new expenses, and you're dropping instead of increasing. So you have to get to look at what that's going to take to cover that cost, okay? And then once you cover that cost, then from that point on, he's making you money. So I would include in all of that commissions if you're going to pay them, bonuses if you're going to pay them, you know, all those kind of things that keep quality people happy. Benefits if you're going to offer them. And see, that's a difficult thing too, is because if you're going to have somebody come in and there are no benefits, then they are going to have to trust you and believe in you and believe in what you're doing to build to the point where you can offer benefits. So that's all of that you have to consider, all of that stuff. And then at that point, when you think, okay, my number is $500 a day, this guy has to create $500 a day of new revenue in order to break even. And so you've got to either be killing yourself, in other words, you're building up so much that you can cover, or that's just a cost that you're willing to eat while he grows. So if, you know, you mentioned having larger accounts and all of that. So if your larger accounts can help you cover those costs, then you can bring that guy on. If your revenue stream is close, I'd say no, don't bring him in yet. Create a bigger revenue stream, even though it's killing you to do it. Maybe you're working 6 days a week, you know, and you're not giving yourself any time off.
Exactly.
You know, you're doing what it takes in order to be able to bring this guy in, so that you're not cutting it so close to this. Because the last thing you want to do is bring a guy in, train him, invest a lot into him, have him understand your culture, but then you're in the slow part of the year.
In the what? I'm sorry?
Slow part of the year. Mm-hmm. So now you're in the winter. And everything drops off. And so unless you've got a lot of commercial accounts to help keep things even, you're going to lose a lot of your residential. It's going to go down as people decide, well, am I going to buy another Christmas present, or am I going to pay for pest control? Probably going to buy another present.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah. So there's just things like that you have to consider. So I think in order to grow, the first thing you have to do is figure out exactly how much it's going to cost you to have that guy, and make sure that those costs are at least covered. And then you can, and then after that, you can build that.
Gotcha. Okay, that's good advice, yeah. Because I feel like I'm overwhelming myself and overworking, so that's why I'm kind of curious, when can I hire someone? I just want to hire at the right time, like you said, because there's a lot of expenses.
Right now, we're actually going into the fall. And if your experience, and every company is different, but if your experience is that revenue drops during the winter, and it may not drop until like January. So November and December, because we live in a warmer climate, may be okay, but then January, February, and really March may be really slow months. So one of the things to consider is actually to have a banker, which I have one, and you should too, and get a line of credit. Mm-hmm. Now, here's the problem with getting a line of credit is usually you have to be in business for a minimum of 2 years mm-hmm. before they'll give you one. So either wait until the spring mm-hmm. so you know that your revenue is going to be rising and then you have a full year, and then maybe your second anniversary will come through in that year and then you can get that line of credit.
Okay.
Which will help you through future years.
Exactly. Good point.
So.
Good point. Very good point. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we got that. Let's see. Okay. You already told me this, but can you repeat this? Out of all the ads that you have spent, which one gave you the best return on investment? I think you mentioned before that you don't really spend on advertisement. Or
we really don't. But I'm gonna say this: having an excellent web guy.
Mm-hmm.
Is super important.
And when you say web, it's website?
I'm talking about a website, and I'm not talking about just the website. Your website has to work for you.
Mm-hmm.
It can't just be a presence.
Mm-hmm.
It has to actually work for you. And Google has all kinds of requirements mm-hmm. about what works for you and what doesn't work for you. And you and I don't have a clue what those things are. But my web guy, who's what's known as a Google partner, gets told everything that Google, like we were told, and he was told that Google in the fourth quarter, one of its primary things it's gonna use for its search engine is current reviews.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to be out there creating current reviews. If you got reviews that are a year old or 2 years old or whatever, Google's not gonna count them. They want new ones, they want fresh ones. And they're gonna use that to elevate a company in the normal generic searches. So, you know, what they call an organic search, mm-hmm. where maybe they don't know your name and they don't know you exist, but they just type in pest control mm-hmm. near me, or just roach control or whatever. Mm-hmm. In order for you to come up in that search, there's all these different algorithms that are used. Mm-hmm. And so if your web guy knows what those are, he's gonna have all those keywords, he's gonna do all those things for you, and you can just go do your business. And when COVID started in March of 20, that's when everything was shut down, was in March of 20, I did two things. I joined a business group, BNI, and I hired my web guy. And I grew 24.89% that year.
How much?
24.89%. During COVID.
During COVID. Wow, that is.
The next year I grew another 11%. Mm-hmm. And the only thing I ever did was join the business group,
mm-hmm.
BNI,
yeah.
and have my web guy work. So I'm not out TikToking.
For sure.
I'm an old guy. You know? And social media is a huge presence now, mm-hmm. and so I've got to learn it.
Oh, yeah. You got to hop on it.
Got to hop on it.
Definitely. Okay, good. Thank you. Let's see. When training your techs, is there a program that you make them go through, or you just teach them all personally?
At this point, mm-hmm. I teach them personally. And a big part of that is because of the culture. I want them to see how we deal with customers. Mm-hmm. I want them to watch me deal with customers. And now, an average technician, after he goes through his basic training of his book, his hours that he mm-hmm. has to get, the on-the-job training can take a minimum, 2 weeks,
mm-hmm.
and then he's cut loose.
Sure.
And go out and do pest control. And my way of thinking, you can't learn anything very well in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
When I brought in my first tech, he spent probably 60 days going around with other people,
mm-hmm.
myself and the former owner of the company, Ronald, who still works with me. And we taught him the culture. And you can't get the culture in 2 weeks. I don't think you can get the... I think 60 days? Yeah.
It takes a while.
So much knowledge. There's a lot to learn,
mm-hmm.
but if you learn how we treat customers, and if you learn that the customer is more important than anything else that's going on,
mm-hmm.
and if you really get that in your head and then begin to perform both the task at hand and just your overall concept is that the customer is more important than anything in the world, then you can be one of my techs and you can learn how the business, all the, you know, all the book learning, all the practical stuff, like the practical way to kill a certain kind of ant or get a certain kind, that's all learnable. But the attitude, what it takes to keep a customer, to earn a customer, keep a customer, make a customer happy, that's something a lot of times that's cultural and it's personality. And I think that's why pest control companies who hire in really quickly and bring in people quickly, I think that's why they have problems, is because they can't bring in people that quickly and maintain their culture, which is why I don't do the door-to-door thing, because you do grow very rapidly doing that, but then you have to bring in a whole bunch of people, and they're strangers. And everybody you bring in new is a stranger, and you have to learn who they are, and they have to learn who you are, and that all takes time, and that's slow growth. But I think it's good growth.
Oh yeah, much better, because a technician can make or break a business.
Well, it's like I tell all of my customers, if the guy who comes out to your house is great, you think the company's great. So there's lots of people out there who think the big box company is wonderful because their technician's wonderful. And it's true. As long as their tech is good, that company is good. But if your tech is bad, that company's bad. And so your techs are everything. They are the company. As far as that customer goes, they are the company. And if they see three or four different techs a year, instead of seeing the same guy, they never really get to learn who the company is, and you never really get to tell them.
Yeah, they're the face of the company.
Yeah.
Very, very true. Very true. And so, talking about, now that we're in that topic, so how do you hire? Do you go through Indeed? Do you go through referrals? Or how do you get your right technician?
I have not had to hire from outside of people I know yet. But here's my concept, and I'm going to share it with you. I believe that it's a real good thing to hire a young person who's been in the military. Because they have learned some discipline. They have an idea of what a team concept is. They have a whole lot of training already. And if they were honorably discharged and, you know, just decided, hey, you know, I served my 6 years and whatever, and I'm done, most of the time they didn't spend enough time in there to get a specialty, something that they're really good at, that they can come out and work. And they're looking for a career. They're looking for something. And in pest control, you can find a career. Now, as you know, when you're training somebody, as was what actually happened with you, you're training your competition. So how do you keep that from happening? That's the key. You've got to figure out how, when you're training somebody, how to keep them. And keep them from taking your customers, because that's really true. And you can sign a non-compete and all that kind of stuff, but unless you're going to take somebody to court and all that,
it takes a while.
The whole process and all that kind of stuff. So my concept of hiring outside of people I already know is to work with a vet.
I never thought about that. That's actually really smart. So I feel like that's your next step.
That is my next step. My next step in the next, you know, 6 months or so is to find that guy.
Exactly.
Or gal. There's some ladies in this business who do real good.
Oh yeah.
And they really like it.
Big time.
And they're well received, because it's something people really don't expect.
Of course.
To be honest with you. Because you don't see that too many ladies in this business.
Oh yeah, the amount of trust that the customer gets once they see a lady is crazy. Because I remember when I was working at Terminate, like, the ladies had the best reputation at the company.
They usually do. And they also do real well in the sales end of it. So they do well on both ends.
That's true. Very true. Okay. And then so to wrap it up, how many is it? Yes. Oh, two more questions. How many stops do you put to on your technicians a day?
That really depends on what you're going to be doing. You know, if it's a rodent situation, they're going to need to do some inspection work. Mm-hmm. They're going to need to figure out what's going on. Then they're going to need to you know, formulate a plan, and whether it's trapping or trapping and sealing or whatever. And so that takes a little more time than going in and treating for just general pests. Mm-hmm. You know, no, I don't really have anything. I just want us to keep up with it. You know, that kind of job is going to take a certain length of time, and depends on the size of the house. But I generally think 6 to 8 jobs is all a tech can do well. Mm-hmm. I do know that many times the big guys are doing 10 to 12.
At Terminus, I was doing 15, I think 20 at the most.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
And so that's not, once again, that just doesn't go with the culture. Mm-hmm. You know, that's more your marketing, and your people are staying with you because of your name. Mm-hmm. And they think, well, they've got to be a good quality. They're big, so they've got to be good. And sometimes that's true. Once again, it's the tech. It's the guy who's at your house. Mm-hmm. So if you've got a good guy, great. If you've got a newbie, somebody who was just picked up after the winter and trained for 2 weeks, you know, hopefully you don't have a complicated situation. They'll be able to take care of you.
Risky. So, okay, last question to wrap it up. How long did it take you to have your own office, or did you get it from the start?
I had it when I purchased the company that it mm-hmm. existed. Really, in the pest control business, though, it's unless you're retailing, mm-hmm. you don't need any place special. You know, you just need to meet the requirements that the state has. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to have chemical or store chemical, you have to, you know, have the proper requirements for that. But a lot of companies don't. A lot of companies just buy their product as they need it, mm-hmm. and they don't really have an inventory, mm-hmm. so they don't have anything special that they need to do mm-hmm. To take care of that. So, you know. You can work out of your garage for a long time, mm-hmm. or just out of your house for a long time, and then you know, grow to the point where you need to have more space to park trucks, exactly. and a safe place to park trucks. So you usually have to have it fenced, you know, and all mm-hmm. that kind of stuff. Or you let your trucks technicians take their trucks home. Now, the problem with that is you know, personal use of the truck mm-hmm. and all, and whether you're going to equip them with GPS and mm-hmm. you know, go through all of that. So,
do you have that on your trucks, the GPS, or you make them come back to the office?
We don't right now. They're either, you know, as we grow, I mean, the plan is probably at this point in the beginning is to use GPS. Mm-hmm. And just tell them, hey, you know, it's GPS equipped. You pay attention, take it home and park it, and bring it back in, and then when we move out of here, we're gonna have to move to a place that has a yard mm-hmm. or can be fenced, mm-hmm. either has one already or whatever.
Definitely. Okay. Well, sir, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate you answering all my questions and for your time. Yeah, very knowledgeable. I like that. And I'm trying to be, you know?
Yeah.
Because you have a lot of experience. 30 years, only been in the industry for 3 years. You know, there's so much to learn. I'm still learning.
Oh, yeah. You're going to learn a lot. There's lots of things mm-hmm. you'll learn, and you'll make lots and lots of mistakes. And, you know, the interesting thing about that is if you can make all the mistakes in the world, as long as you say, I need to fix that. Mm-hmm. And your customers will let you make 100 mistakes as mm-hmm. long as you come back and say, let me fix it. Mm-hmm. You know, most of them are very understanding, and they know you're doing your best. So don't be afraid to make mistakes.
Thank you, Stuart. Any last advice like you can give me or to the audience on starting a business, like on expanding and growing?
Love what you do. Don't do things just to make money. Mm-hmm. You can make a whole lot of money and be unhappy. Mm-hmm. and you can make a whole lot of money and be happy. So just make sure you love what you do and that you are taking care of everybody. Take care of your people, people you work with. Take care of the people who are paying your salary, that's your customer. And just take care of the public in general. It always comes back. You know, so you'll be able to expand because you can make mistakes. It's not a big deal. Mm-hmm. Most people don't do stuff because they're afraid of making mistakes. They're afraid it'll cost them. What costs you is not doing something and being afraid to make a mistake. It's better to make a mistake and then just fix it.
Love it. And then can you end it with your slogan? I love your slogan. I love his slogan.
At Texas A1 Pest Control, we don't just make it happen. We're out there killing it every day.
Killing every single day. Thank you, Stuart.